Good evening, and how many of you are here for the first time? Let me see your little hands. Just a couple of you. Oh, welcome. And normally, I'm not preaching. I don't think I've been in this pulpit in a very long time. But Jim and I, for those of you that are new, we started this church 27 years ago, almost 28. And we started this church with 12 people in a box of Kleenex, and I still have Kleenex in my hands, and it wasn't because we have a runny nose, it was because we had broken hearts. And we had a small church up in Lake Arrowhead, and it was our Bible school, and I think I was 37 when we moved down here, and Jim was 5 years older than I was, and Luke was just a little guy, he was not even 5 years old yet, and Jess was just a couple years older than he was, and Miranda was on her way to school, college. Miranda, welcome tonight, my grandson, one of my grandchildren, and Miranda. Miranda, just can you just wave at people? That's one of my daughters, and they have the Rock Church of Temecula, and it's just amazing what's happening there. It's exploding. And so almost 28 years ago, we started this church, and we started it, and what it is today and what's happened is because of what I'm going to speak to you tonight on my part, on my spot, and what God called me to do. And when we started this church, we never dreamed that it would be what it is today. We didn't have that big of a dream in our hearts, but God had a dream. And I wanted to speak to you tonight about something that is on my heart, and it's actually started in the women's ministry, and they're preaching on prayer. And they started this season with prayer and fasting, and the women are Jessica, who's taken the women's ministry, is preaching on prayer. And so I shared with girlfriends, they changed the name as Women Rock, on Thursday, and I began with a story. Now, my family's heard this story, and they're probably sick of hearing it, but I'm going to tell it to you because you probably haven't heard it yet, and if you have, oh, well, you're going to hear it again. But let me say this about prayer. Everything in the kingdom of God is established in prayer. Everything in the kingdom of God is sustained by prayer. And everything in God's kingdom is successful because of prayer. Prayer is communicating and talking and sharing and experiencing God. And it's not just you talking to him or me talking to him. It's him talking to us. And there's many, many things, and there's many ways, and we could be praying, and we could be teaching on prayer until Jesus comes, and we probably will be. And I've got about 45 minutes tonight plus, and I don't want to keep too long, and I'd like to actually do a little bit of praying, but I don't know about you, but lately, my prayer life really has kind of stunk. Has anybody else felt that way? Seems like, have you ever had prayers that you've prayed and they don't get answered? Have you ever prayed for something and it didn't happen? Have you prayed and you feel like your prayers just go to the ceiling and they don't go any further than that? How about have you ever prayed and you're just not focused and your mind just bings around and it goes everywhere and you're trying so hard but you just can't keep focused? Anybody have that problem? Well, you're human, just like me. And this is not to make you feel guilty, this message. This message is not to make you feel like you've come to church and I've just piled on one more thing in the list of to-dos for your life. What I hope to accomplish tonight is to whet your appetite and to stir your spirit to begin to do what I believe the Holy Spirit is speaking to us as a body here at the Rock and across this nation. And my son just sent me a little article that Pastor Jack Hayford, who's head of the Foursquare denomination, had just posted online about calling his Foursquare denomination to prayer. And Luke emailed it to me, and I read it, and it resonated in my spirit. And I believe that we are coming into a season of very strategic time in history. And I believe that if we are hearing the Holy Spirit and if we are one body, then God is going to be speaking the same thing to all the churches. Would you agree with that? But I told you I wanted to start with a story, and this is about prayer. And 27 years ago, we started this church, and every ministry here and every pillar that you see, this church represents seven pillars. And the first pillar, the thing that holds this church up, what makes the Rock its personality and its vision, the foundation of the Rock was what God told us: upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. The Rock being the revelation that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. and that the Word of God and Jesus Christ, the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Son, that's the foundation of our faith, the staple of our faith. But there's pillars. Wisdom has built her house. She's hewn out her seven pillars. There's a frame that makes churches what they are. It's a family, and every family has its culture. And God began to, through the years, evolve and teach us what he wanted for this church. And the very first thing that came forth was the pillar of a passion for souls, the wells of salvation. That was birthed in prayer. Then if you're going to have new people, well, you got to teach them. That was discipleship. That's a commandment from Jesus. Make disciples. Then God said, you got to have healthy relationships. You're a family. If you don't have healthy relationships, you'll break apart. Unity and oneness and koinonia is very important. Third pillar. And God said, if you're not going to be a selfish inward church, you're going to have to learn how to go outside of yourselves, and your city is your church, and then your state and your nation, and then the nations. So we had to learn how to actually do good, that good works, and that God wanted us outside of ourselves. To get a bigger vision that the church wasn't inside the building, the church was outside the building. Birthed in prayer. Then from good works, we realized that from good works, we actually had to have evangelism, world missions, that God had a mandate and said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Therefore, we had to get outside of our city, outside of our nation. We had to go into the highways and the byways of the planet. And that missions was born, prayer. Then from there, we realized, well, gee, if we're going to do this, we better be training leadership, because God's got to raise up leaders, because this church has grown. And there came the Bible school. Then from there, we realized that God wants to plant churches all over the world. And there came the seventh pillar, planting churches. Those things were birthed in prayer with me and with others. But God specifically used me next to my husband, who was the reluctant pastor that didn't want a pastor, that didn't want to start a church. Wanted to be a businessman and was hoping God had set him free from pastoring forever. But you see, God had a different plan, and that plan was birthed in prayer. So I was Jim's intercessor, and I was this church's intercessor. This church, before it was ever birthed, God had a name for it and a dream and a vision for it, and he needed somebody to pray for. What did I know? I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer. I'm not some prayer warrior. I'm not there to sit on my knees for hours and hours like Reese Howell, intercessor, and others. I'd read prayer books, and I'd want to throw them away and just say, God, come on. I can't do this. I got three little kids. But you see, it's not about how long, and it's not about how many words. It's about the heart connecting with God. And listening. And if you'll listen tonight, God wants to speak to us, because he's calling his church into a season of unprecedented prayer. Because the rages and the ravages of hell are being unleashed on this planet. And the church is God's body on this earth. And so, having said that, Father, I just ask that you'd help me through tonight. I wouldn't ramble and move on and on. You know how I can be, God. Just help me to say what you need me to say to my people. In Jesus' name, amen. So I want to tell you a story. So there's been this transition. Now, I prayed and I prayed and I prayed. I've seen miracles. I've seen the rock come. God told me the name of the church, prayed in the altar call about the wells of salvation, the birds. I mean, just, I can give you testimony after testimony about prayer. But we've transitioned, and we knew the next generation had to take this church, and so Jim and I stepped back. Well, that wasn't an easy thing. If you think that's an easy thing, to give and step back from the very thing that was your passion, it's not. And so I've been going through a year of transition and doing a new dance and trying not to lead where I'm not supposed to lead and say things when I'm not supposed to say things and, you know, just try to be the cheerleader from behind. And I'm learning that position. There's a lot of death taking place. And so my prayer life really hasn't been very great. And can I just be honest with you? But God did something. And it's not that I don't pray. I pray all the time. I talk to God continually. But I mean specific, focused, fervent, faith-filled, word-based prayer that got things done. I was with Jim about a month ago. Probably by now it's a month ago. And I was on the docks of San Diego because we have a sailboat and we were looking for a new slip. And so as we were looking at this slip, it didn't work out. And we were walking in. All of a sudden, a pelican swept by and I really didn't even notice it. And Jim said, "What's that?" And I looked and he said, "Look." And there down right at my feet was a seahorse. Now, I've never seen a seahorse outside of an aquarium in some Long Beach or Monterey. Have you ever seen a seahorse, just seen a seahorse in the ocean? I haven't. And there at my feet was a seahorse. His little face looked just like a horse. It was beautiful. It was iridescent. It had fallen out of the pouch of that pelican that was about to have it for a meal. Now, God says in Romans chapter 1, that creation and all things speak of the Godhead, speak of him. And the fact that it just fell right at my feet, and there I am staring at it, was shocking. But then something happened, because on the inside of me, in my spirit being, all of a sudden, there was an overwhelming groaning and compassion for this creature. And it wasn't natural. And I just began to look at this creature, and I just began to say, and my heart was breaking for this creature that I thought was dead. It was just lying there. And God said, "Pick it up." And I scooped down, and I put it carefully. I mean, it was just about 6 inches, had a little curly tail. And I scooped down, and I picked it up very carefully, and I put it in my hand. And now the seahorse was in my hand. And this seahorse, its little tail, you know how it's curled like that? Y'all see a seahorse in your mind, right? Its little tail wrapped around my little finger. And God said, "Speak life. Take dominion. This creature needs you right now." I know this sounds crazy and silly, a seahorse. But God was awakening in my spirit the fact of who I was and what he needed me to do. To stand and take my place as a daughter of God. To stand and begin to declare life, take dominion, and be who I'm supposed to be. And the thing that was in need of my dominion and my authority through the blood of Jesus Christ was now in my hand, and it was dying. And God said, "Speak life to this creature and begin to tell it to live and not die." And I began to speak life over that seahorse. And that seahorse began to hang onto my finger. And I walked over to the ocean, to the dock side, and I began to let it down into the water. And it would not let go of me. It would not let go of my hand. And God said, "Release it and tell it to live and not die and to be blessed." And that's exactly what I did. I said, "Off you go. You can't stay with me. You will live and you will not die. And if you can talk seahorse to your friends, you tell them that the daughters of God are alive and well on planet Earth. And you be blessed in the name of Jesus." And I blessed God's creation. Now you may think I'm nuts, but that was a God moment for me. How many people have ever had a seahorse drop right in front of them? Dead, comes to life, hangs onto your hand, won't let you go, and God commands you to speak life. He was sharing something with me. That God needs his people, specifically where I was at with him, to begin to come alive, stand up once again, be who we're supposed to be, and begin to be like our Father and speak those things that are not as if they were, decree and have dominion of this earth, and begin to believe in what God has dreamed for planet Earth and not what Satan and the ravages of hell are planning for this nation and this world. But it's not going to happen by just wishful thinking. It's not going to happen by hoping. It's not going to happen by us just doing good works and going out and feeding the hungry and clothing the poor. This thing that God needs done now is going to be birthed in a warfare of prayer that must begin and is happening. And God needs the church to pray like we've never prayed. I'm going to read you something. 2 Chronicles 7:14 says, it's not on the overhead, so I'm just going to read it. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land. 1 Timothy 2:1-2 says, therefore I exhort, first of all, that all supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, not some men, for kings and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. I am concerned about my country. I'm concerned about my nation. I'm very concerned about the state of our union and the state that we are in. And I am old enough to remember way back in the dark ages when television only had 3 channels. And Ricky and Lucy had twin beds. And I've seen such changes in our nation. I've seen our national debt rise to such staggering proportions that we can't wrap our minds around $19 trillion. Nor can we pay it back in the natural. I've seen laws come into legislation that should never come in, redefining family. The very building blocks of God's society has been redefined by a Supreme Court that was not elected but was appointed. I've seen our nation become greedy and prejudiced and filled with hatred and filled with violence and filled with things that it should never be filled with. I've seen us take God out of the schools. I've seen us take God out of Christmas and Christ out of Christmas. I've seen our churches grow bigger and bigger and bigger, but where is the power? Mega churches, but where's the power? Could it be that God wants to do a new thing? And he wants to arrest this before it's too late. We're falling off a cliff. We're on a sound foundation economically. Now, I'm not here to preach doom and gloom. I'm here to preach faith and hope. But there is something we need to do as a body of people. And we need to pray for this country. And we need to pray for our city. We need to learn how to pray for the lost. Now, when I was a young believer, and I was coming back to the Lord out of a life of complete and absolute rebellion and sin. I was in a church, a denomination. It was a good denomination. I praise God for it. It welcomed me in. It housed me in Miranda. And it was a beautiful, beautiful church. I'm not here to bash any church. But the theology of this church was, well, why pray if God is sovereign? And it was young believers. Why do we really need to pray if God is sovereign and he's in control? Really, then why pray? Because his will's going to happen anyway. It was a good question. Well, why pray? I mean, God's sovereign. He's going to get done. So turn with me to Ezekiel chapter 22. And God had to teach me this as a young woman. These are familiar scriptures, but that's all right. In Ezekiel chapter 22, God's speaking, and he's talking about the condition of the land. He's looking at the political structure, the religious structure, and the culture of the land. And it says here, I'll just start with verse 26. It says, her priests have violated my law, profaned my holy things. They have not distinguished between the holy and the unholy, nor have they made known the difference between the unclean and the clean. They have hidden their eyes from my Sabbath so that I am profaned among them. So here's the religious community completely backslidden. Verse 27, her princes in her midst are like wolves tearing the prey to shed blood to destroy people and get dishonest gain. That sounds like the Senate and the Congress. The political structure, absolutely in disarray. And then verse 29, the people of the land have used oppressions, committed robbery, and mistreated the poor and the needy. They've wrongfully oppressed the stranger. So now we see the culture itself has become cruel and rude and heinous. Does it remind you of any place? And God says so in verse 30. So, because the political, the religious, and the culture is completely backslidden. So, I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land that I should not destroy it. But I found none. Listen, politically, spiritually, and culturally, Israel's bankrupt, just like America. God said, I sought for a man to stand in the gap and make up a wall. That means to intercede, to be the one that can go before me on their behalf so that I would not destroy it. You know, sometimes now in the churches, I hear, God just needs to nuke it all. God just needs to come back. But you see, that's not the plan of God right now. God doesn't want to destroy America. He doesn't want to destroy people and nations. He doesn't want to nuke the Middle East and nuke North Korea. He doesn't want to see China gone. He wants to see the nations come to Jesus, because my Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish. God loves humanity. He loves this planet. He loves this earth. He loves our city. He loves our nation. He loves our state. He loves the races. And God is looking for a church to stand on the gap on behalf of fallen mankind, stupid mankind, sinful mankind, ridiculous mankind, and stand in the gap as intercessors and make up the hedge on behalf of the land that he would not destroy it. It's prayer. But I can't pray if I don't care. I can't pray if my heart is hard. I can't pray if I just excuse it all and say, oh, God's going to have his way and we're just on a timetable. Well, guess what? We can change God's timetable. There needs to be a revival before the Lord can come back. And this gospel has to be preached to every nation before the end comes. We're not done yet. It's not beam me up, Scotty. We've got a lot of work to do. And hell is raging against the plan of God. And the church needs to arise and awaken and come alive. And the hardest thing to do, but the most powerful thing we can do, is pray privately and corporately as a people. Because it was prayer changed my life. It was prayer that birthed the things here at the Rock. It was prayer that brought forth the wells of salvation and gave Jim that altar call and called people to repentance. It was prayer that caused the hard-hearted to have a godly sorrow so that the Holy Spirit could turn their hard hearts from sin to righteousness and they could be convicted in their seats. As my husband and others began to preach the gospel to them, they could hear because somebody stood in the gap, and Loopy and others and intercessors all over this church and for years have prayed in the things that have happened. And I'm just here to say, I am calling forth as the Nana of this church, as the old woman of this church, perhaps it's time once again, Rock, to rise and awaken and come to a season of prayer like we've never had before, because I believe God wants to pour out his spirit, break this drought spiritually and physically, and reign righteousness on this place. But he's asking us, will we pray? Will we pray? So having said that, I'm sorry. I'm not going to apologize. I'm old. I shouldn't be this loud. So go figure. Matthew 21:13 says, my house should be called a house of prayer for all nations. You've made it a den of thieves. When he was whipping the money changers in the courts of God, the zeal of the Lord of hosts, the zeal for God's house had eaten him up. Romans 12:12 says, rejoice in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing steadfastly in prayer. Colossians 4:2, continue earnestly in prayer, being vigilant in it with thanksgiving. 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. Luke 18:1-2, and he spoke a parable to them that men always ought to pray and not lose heart. He told a parable. Listen, prayer is the believer's battle. It is the very battle that we are called to put on our weapons of warfare for and to engage in. Ephesians, I know these are familiar scripture, but can I just remind you, it's not to put guilt on you because we're not praying. It's to say, Lord, if this is you, stir our hearts and help us to pray. Help us to pray. Help us not to disappoint you. You know, did anybody see War Room? How many saw War Room? Man, I saw War Room. I came back out of my closet. My shoes just about knocked me out. I think I did it for a couple of days. I am being so honest with you. This is not to put guilt on you, but this is to stir and let God speak to us. Bring us accountability. Maybe we'll be stronger together. Maybe we need a war room in the chapel every day. I don't know. Maybe we need a prayer clock and we can come and open the chapel and you come on your lunch hours. I don't know. God's got a plan. Jim and I, when we had Lake Arrowhead Christian Fellowship, it was in the 80s, and a great pastor had gotten a revelation of the Lord's Prayer. He taught and showed the church that it was an outline. It wasn't something you say fast. It was an outline. We all studied the outline, and then came the message, can you not tarry 1 hour? So we were told, you got to pray 1 hour. Can't you even pray 1 hour? So our whole church at Lake Arrowhead Christian Fellowship, we got up every morning, 5 o'clock in the morning. We were all there to pray every morning. I dragged my kids out of bed. They were 3 and 4 years old. In Lake Arrowhead, it was freezing. We bundled them up in sleeping bags. We bought them donuts and hot cocoa, and we opened up our little church. And Jim and I and about 4 other people would gather every morning, and we would pray in the harvest, and we'd pray in the Lord's Prayer. We did it for years. Did we see that church grow? No. But we saw this one grow. Did it hurt our kids being yanked out of bed at 5 o'clock in the morning when they were just little? No, because they're all serving God today, preaching the gospel. You see, God says, if you'll pray. Ephesians 1, 21 and 23. Now, why? Why do we pray? God's sovereign, but he's made us his body on the earth. And I want to read this in the Message Bible about Jesus being head of the church. And it says that Jesus is in charge of running the universe, everything from galaxies to governments. No name and no power exempt from his rule, and not just for the time being, but forever. He's in charge of it all, has the final word on everything. At the center of all this, Christ rules the church. The church, you see, is not peripheral to the world. It's not on the outside looking in. Peripheral means outside. The church, you see, is not peripheral to the world. The world is peripheral to the church. The church is Christ's body in which he speaks and acts, by which he fills everything with his presence. The church is Christ's body. The church is Christ's body. The church is Christ's body, which he speaks and acts, by which he fills everything with his presence. My goodness. If that's true, and it is, then what he wants on this earth is only going to come through as you and I pray it in. Because we're his body. And prayer is training in rulership for heaven. It's training. We are in a training ground. We are learning how to live in the agape love of the new nature of God. We are learning how to walk by faith and not by sight. And God says prayer is your weapon. It's your battle. It is your training ground. It's like a safety deposit box. I've given you a key. I've got the key, and when you and I unlock the key together, the treasures of heaven are released and open and comes to the earth. Intercessors, my gosh, the treasures of heaven are waiting to be prayed into this planet. Wow. So, how do we pray? Well, first thing we got to do is, I guess we have to get honest about where our prayer life is. I do. What, God doesn't know? See, if we can keep a secret from him? Look, 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. I have learned over these years with God that I have a continual conversation with the Holy Spirit. I wake up in the morning and I talk to God. I go to bed at night and I say goodnight before I close my eyes. I have a conversation going all the time. But intercession and supplication and petition is a whole different thing. Let me give you this story. You are, hypothetically, the child of the king. Whether you're a man or a woman. If you're a man, you're a prince. If you're a daughter, you're a princess. And you grew up with the king. You're in the palace. Dad tucks you in at night. He kisses you. You have breakfast with the king in the morning. You know him. He knows you. You're his child. You love him. And you have an ongoing fellowship with him continually. Praying without ceasing. You're practicing the presence of your Father, right? But now you have a real need, or somebody that is important in your life has a real specific need. Now, the only one that can fix this and help this is your Father, the King. You're not going to just run to him and just casually tell him about it, because this is so important that if he doesn't hear you and if you don't get this request, it's not going to happen. Your friend's going to be destroyed. So you're going to think about what you're going to say, and you're going to make sure that you have a time where Dad has your ear and he's not distracted with other things. And it's you and him, and you're going to lay out your need, and you're going to lay out your petition, and you're going to lay out your request. And by virtue of your relationship with your Father, you believe that he can fix this and he will grant your request. That, my darlings, is intercession and specific prayer. It's not something you just casually do, throw up a prayer, but it's something you actually hunker down, search the scriptures, and you get your petition, and then you go before the one that you already know and love, and you begin to make your petition known to him. That's the prayer of faith. You pray according to the will of God and the word of God. So how do we pray? Well, first we make it a priority. I got to start somewhere. Let's start somewhere. Listen, if it's 5 minutes, take 5 minutes. Like I said, I started out in my closet. Oh, my gosh. I shut the door in my little closet, and I have the worst feet. I could empty the sanctuary if I took my shoes off. All I could think about was, oh, my gosh, I need a gas mask in here. It's my own shoes. Jeez. Start somewhere, because you got to focus. Jesus said, when you pray in secret. So if you can't concentrate, and maybe it's in your car, maybe when you're alone, and finally it's just you and the freeway, start somewhere and begin to pray. Make it a priority every day to begin to enhance your prayer life, and ask God to help you give increase to it. Say, God knows where you're at. He's not mad at you. This is not one more discipline that you have to do. No, this is something that I want to do, and he wants you to want to do, because when you want to do it, you'll do it, right? So start somewhere. Make it a priority. The verse for that is Luke 16:16. The law and the prophets were until John. Jesus saying this, since that time, the kingdom of God has been preached and everyone is pressing into it. Well, what the heck does that mean about prayer? What Jesus was saying, and he was talking about John the Baptist and the conflict that was happening in the kingdom. And he was saying, listen, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence and the violent want to take it by force. He says, everyone is pressing in. That word pressing, it's biazo, and it means to force, to seize, to inflict violence. And he says, people are wanting to get into the kingdom of God because he came and demonstrated what God was like and what the kingdom was. He came to bring us the kingdom. The blind were seeing. The dead were being raised. The lame were walking. The sick were being healed. There were miracles and signs and wonders. And he was speaking things people had never heard. And the kingdom of heaven had come unto him. And people wanted to get into it, but they wanted in their own way. Jesus is saying to us, everyone is pressing in. What does that mean to me in prayer? Well, listen, there's a violence that I have to have in my life to press into the kingdom of God, because it is not just going to happen. Listen, passivity in churches is not spiritually correct. All passivity will do when we are passive and kind and nice and we preach about love and grace and good works. Oh, yeah, we'll absolutely be kind and we'll be politically correct and people will like us and pat us on the back. But a church that is not pressing into fervent prayer, confronting the demonic, expecting signs, wonders, and miracles, and expecting a passion for souls and new salvations is not having any impact in the kingdom of God. So start somewhere. Confronting the demonic, passionate prayer, caring about the lost. Listen, I didn't care about the lost. I didn't care about people going to hell. God had to turn my heart. Maybe that's you right now. If you will ask him, if I can have compassion for a seahorse, my God, help me. May that compassion that I felt, may the scriptures that ran into my spirit, creation groaning for the sons to be revealed, may that passion be multiplied as I see souls walking by me headed for hell. May I begin to have a passion for the lost and the blinded and the lonely and the bankrupt. God, help me to pray in the harvest and once again pray in the souls to this place. God will help us, but we've got to press in. Flaming hearts, keeping our hearts alive and on fire for him. It doesn't matter how old, I can be 90 years old and be more on fire than I was when I was 37. Age has nothing to do with this. You could be a brand new believer. You've been saved for 2 weeks and you can pray heaven down and you can pray God's plan into the earth. You're a child of the King now. So what are some things to do? Well, make it a priority. Start somewhere. How about this one? Ask in his name. When you pray, Jesus said, John 14, whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, and that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I'll do it. The name of Jesus. It isn't a slot machine. It's all that his name represents. All that his name has paid for, the authority and the grounds of my prayer of faith is what Jesus Christ has done at Calvary's cross, that he became the Lamb of God. He took the sin of the world upon himself. He released his spirit to the Father. He went down to the depths of hell. Death could not hold him. He was an innocent lamb. He took the keys of death and hell. He raised from the dead. He's seated at the right hand, and he has endorsed and sent his authority to the church and said, all power has been given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore into all the world. Preach this gospel to every nation. That delegated authority has been given to us. So I pray in his name when I go to the Father. I say, Father, I'm here in the name of my King. I'm here in the name of Yeshua. I'm here in the name of Jesus. I'm here in the blood of the Lamb. I'm here in his righteousness. I'm here in all that he's paid for. I'm here in all the promises that he has promised for us. Oh, God, I come in the mighty name of Jesus, and I ask you, Father. And you begin to ask in his name. He said, if you ask in my name anything, I'll do it for you. Priorities. Start somewhere. Ask in his name. Ask for wisdom. Man, Jim and I, we don't know always what to pray for. It's not like the chapter and verse on where we're supposed to go start a business or what we're supposed to do next. Have you found that out? Who you're supposed to marry is not in Ezekiel chapter 24, verse 8. You got a life to live, do you not? You got jobs and people to marry and kids to raise and you have retirements to think about and you've got a life in the 21st century. God, he says, ask, bring your needs to me. But he says, and this is what I love, in James chapter 1, verse 5, he says, if any of you lack wisdom, ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it'll be given to him. God, I don't know what we're supposed to do. I don't know where we're supposed to go. I don't know who I'm supposed to marry. I don't know what job I'm supposed to take. And what you do is you begin to ask and you begin to seek and you begin to knock. It's not time yet to pray the prayer of faith because you don't know what it is yet. You are now asking the Lord. That takes time. Proverbs 16:3 says, roll your works, your life on the Lord, and he will cause your thoughts to become agreeable with his will. And so shall your plans be established and succeed. As you begin to ask and seek him, he'll reorder your thoughts. He'll reorganize your mind. Suddenly what was just muddied waters becomes clear. Suddenly what you didn't really understand, suddenly all of a sudden the penny drops, the light comes on, and you go, oh. Now faith begins to come in your spirit. You find a promise of God now to that thing. Now you can go to him and ask in his name and ask in faith. Are you with me? Almost finished. How about this one? Ask in faith. Now you can pray the prayer of faith. Mark 11:23 and 24, and I'm almost done. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, I love it, everything has ears. God spoke to everything. Fig trees, storms, everything has ears. Everything. Be removed and be cast into the sea, and do not doubt in his heart, but believes those things that he says will be done. He'll have whatever he says. Therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you'll have them. You see, when you know what to pray now, now I have faith for this. Now I have God's promise. Now I have God's direction. Now you go to God and you pray the prayer of faith. You say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I see that it's your will that I be healed. Lord, I've got an ear that is trying to go deaf on me. And I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, that he is Jehovah Rapha. Therefore, I am healed by the stripes of my Lord and my Savior, Jesus Christ. And I thank you for opening my ear. I thank you that I can hear. I thank you that I can see. I thank you that my body is strong. And you begin to pray the promise of God and the prayer of faith. And you believe you receive when you pray it. And God says, you'll have it. You'll have it. But if you don't know what to pray, then begin to seek God and he'll show you. And then he will give you. Why? Because the Holy Spirit wants you to pray more than you do. How about this one? Do what he says. Because that verse also says in verse 25, forgive. And whatever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, that your Father in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. Listen, one thing that'll stop your prayers is bitterness, unforgiveness. It'll stop it all. And that's why the enemy tries so hard to cause division and offenses. Oh, he works hard at that. Because he knows if you are unforgiving and if you have offenses and you stand praying and you need something from God, the first thing that's going to happen. Jesus said, can I have it up there? And whatever you, whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, that your Father in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. You got to do what he says. Open your prayer life. Bitterness, unforgiveness is not worth the price of prison. It's not worth it. Expect miracles. This is the last one, John 5, 14 through 16. Now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. He hears us. He, God, who lives and makes the universe and the invisible world, it's bigger than this one. The God who's the star breather and the one who says the nations are a drop in a bucket to him. The one who has no time but created time. He's eternal. The one that made heaven and earth. The one that wove you in your mother's womb, has the hairs on your head counted, loved you so much he couldn't live without you. The one that rules all things hears your prayer. And it says, and if We know, not him, us. If we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have petitions. We know that we have the petitions that we asked of him. God says, I want you to pray in faith, that I want you to expect me to answer your prayers. Listen, my husband didn't give an altar call. He said, I'm the only person who went to Africa, never gave an altar call. And God said, pray. I said, I don't know how to pray. Took my Bible to prayer because I take my Bible to prayer because God speaks to me in the Word. Taught me a little lesson about Oxaw, Caleb's daughter. I never heard of Oxaw. Caleb had given Oxaw some land, but her husband said, we don't have any water. Go ask your father for wells. So Oxaw went to her dad, Caleb, and said, hey, Dad, you've given me all this land, but I need some water. Caleb loved Oxaw. He says, listen, I'm going to give you the high springs, and I'm going to give you the low springs. As I read that, the Holy Spirit said, now ask the Father for the wells of salvation. And I said, what's that? He says, turn to Isaiah 12:3. I had my Bible. I turned to Isaiah 12:3, and it said, with joy shall you drink from the wells of salvation. He said, ask me for the wells, child. They're plural. Ask me for the wells of salvation. I've given you the land. Now all you need is the water. And you're going to see things you've never seen. You see, that was prayer. You don't know what to do, but God will give you direction in prayer. God will give you understanding in prayer. God will birth into the earth through you. Little nobody me. A little nothing of a woman that when I die, nobody's even going to know who I was. But he knows. See, maybe you think you don't matter. Maybe you think you just sit there and you come every day or you come every Sunday. God knows. And God has a whole community of things he wants to pray through you. He wants to use you. He wants to change the world through your prayers in your life. But beloved, we got to understand, first of all, we need to pray. Not to feel guilty, but oh Lord, help us to pray. We need to make it a priority. Let's begin to ask him for things. If we don't know, then ask for wisdom. Ask in faith once you get the word from God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith comes when God speaks direction into your life. I had those scriptures. God put faith in my heart. I could ask him for it. I could ask him. I knew we were supposed to go to the poor because he gave me scriptures for the poor. And I said, it's a mandate. This isn't something I'm thinking about. This is something he told me to do. So we prayed it in. It's not just me. My gosh, Manion, Loopy, just a whole community of us little girls just pray. And man, wonderful man. I've gone on and on and I'm done. I love my country. I love this country. I love my city. I love my church and I love the Rock churches and I want to see unity like we've never seen. I want to see people healed. I want to see people saved. I want to see God shake this planet, shake this nation yet one more time. So if this stirred your hearts at all, you want to just stand with me? Let's just ask God to help us to pray. You don't have to if you don't want to. I don't want to put you on the spot. Some of you are new. You don't even know me. You probably think this woman's talking about seahorses. She is nuts. You know, Jesus was talking about John the Baptist. He said, of man born of woman, there is none greater than John the Baptist. None greater. But then he said something. He said, but the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John the Baptist. What he was saying is the new birth, the new creation that I'm about to bring as the last Adam, is the one that was going to birth the church and bring forth something that had never been on the earth. The least of those would be greater than John the Baptist, the greatest prophet that ever lived. How much privilege and power God has placed in our lives. So, Father, here we are. We present ourselves to you at the Rock on Sunday, rainy night, January 31st. Lord, I confess my prayerlessness and my lack of passion this last year over prayer, and I ask that you'd forgive me. And I know those that are praying right now, and if, Lord, some of us have just had a hard time praying. Whatever reasons you know. Lord, we just ask you to forgive us. Just forgive us. And Lord, we know that we don't trust ourselves. We can have great intentions and get all stirred up, and then life happens and we get busy, and before you know it, we're back in our old routines. So Father, we're asking that you'd help us with strategies and accountability and with stirrings from the Holy Spirit to awaken us and to help us to pray. The Spirit helps us to pray. When we don't know how to pray, he helps us. So we ask for grace to pray like we've never prayed, Father. We ask that as we come into your presence, privately and collectively as a people, that, Lord, you would teach us to pray, show us what to pray for, and hear our prayers. And may we pray your will as we say, come your kingdom, be done your will. On earth as it is in heaven. So we give this to you now, and we thank you for your help and your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Lovely, huh? Lovely? Good? Yeah, good.